Your friends all love you. They do. They'd swim the ocean if you wanted them to. But babe, nobody loves you like me. Your sister loves you, calls every day. I think she thinks I only get in the way. But babe, nobody loves you like me. Nobody loves you head to your feet, out on the sofa and between the sheets. Love every freckle on your fine, lovely skin. Somebody else comes a knocking, don't let him in. Your mother loves you too much. She thinks it turns to gold whatever you touch. But babe, nobody loves you, baby, head to your toes. I know the little things nobody else knows. So call me selfish, honey, I just don't care. Somebody else wants in, I'm not gonna share. Because I love you to your soul. Love your equator, south, babe. Nobody loves you like me. Yes, I know everybody thinks the world of you, but babe, nobody loves you like me.
Nobody Loves You Like Me from the NOLA record, in the style, a song I wrote in the style of Antoine Domino Jr. And you know who that was. Yes, Fats Domino. Hi, everybody. Welcome to Susie on Sundays. Thank you for tuning in. We realize here at Susie on Sundays, you have your choice of entertainment. Thank you for flying with us in talking about us, speaking of myself, and also my digital coordinator, the wonderful Kelly Lynn Knott, who is running the machinery from Minneapolis. Tonight's program is the Susan Werner Variety Hour, something we've never done before and may never do again, but we have three fabulous acts for you in this 1 hour of amazing entertainment this evening. Welcome to the program. Thanks to you for tuning in tonight via Facebook, Twitter, and YouTube. If you are watching on YouTube, go ahead and subscribe to the channel. I think it's right down here. And also, some people have found that you can bring this show up on your smart TV by speaking into your remote Susan Werner Live YouTube. Susan Werner Live YouTube, and I'll be there on your TV. Now, whether that's something you actually want to look at in high definition or not, well, that is your choice there. But Susan Werner Live YouTube could come up on your TV next Sunday, May 2nd. Hey, everybody, dress up and look nice next Sunday, because my guest is Kathy Mattea, country star. So let's look like we're, deserving of her. Sunday, May 9th is Piano Bar number 4. I'll be taking your requests in real time. So you'll just throw them into the comments and boom, boom, boom. We'll just go. Song after song after song after song. A reminder about fan club cruises, the cruise to Alaska. departs and returns to, departs from and returns to Seattle next May, May 27th. Join us. Fan Club Cruises. That is going to be great fun to Alaska. So we're going to add a little feature tonight, unusual feature. We've never done this before. I may never do it again. But I'll be asking you to determine your name. Your name. So there's a formula for names. Some of you may have heard this before in regard to, yeah. But as we are a, you know, PG-13 kind of show, we won't be doing those names. But we are doing your NPR name. Your NPR name. To figure out your NPR name or your CBC name, for those of you joining us from Canada, you will want to create a name that is unusual and worldly. The formula for your NPR name, and I welcome you posting your NPR name this evening. To create your NPR name, take the first letter of your middle name and insert it anywhere you'd like in your first name. So again, take the first letter of your middle name and insert it anywhere you'd like in your first name. Then your last name is the smallest foreign town you've ever visited. Your last name is the smallest foreign town you've ever visited. My NPR name, for instance, is Sumsan Los Lopez. Okay, I'm Sumsan Los Lopez with National Public Radio, right? So there's your NPR formula. Again, take the first letter of your middle name, insert it anywhere in your first name, and your last name is the smallest foreign town you've ever visited. I look forward to hearing Ron Rosen's NPR name, also Chuck Ellingson. Oh yeah, Ellie Mondini, I want to hear those NPR names. So our first guest tonight, as part of tonight's variety show, joins us from Winnipeg, Manitoba, Canada. We have an international act joining us tonight. So friends, please welcome to the program, Jackson Haldane. Hello, Jackson Haldane.
Hi, Susan. Joining us
from Winnipeg, Manitoba. How are you tonight, hon?
I'm great, thanks. Thanks for having me.
You bet. And I'm so glad that we got to do this. You know, Tressa Levasseur, our friend with the Folk Alliance International, suggested you when I emailed her and said, hey, I'm looking for something, you know, special. And she said, Jackson is the guy you want. So I'm glad you can join us tonight. And without further ado, would you play your first selection for us tonight?
Absolutely.
Ooh.
There we go.
Jackson Haldane. Amazing.
The backing tracks there, but oh, thank you. A little taste of the Tennessee Waltz, if you didn't catch it. I have to admit, I used this pun in the sound check, but I'm a little rusty. I had to knock a bit of rust off, figuratively and literally, to get the old saw out.
There we have the automated laugh for you. Yeah, there
it
is.
Oh, I love it.
Oh, Jackson, how did you learn the musical saw?
Yeah, that's an interesting question. Anytime you ask it to anyone who plays the musical saw, usually. I remember seeing the musical saw played as a child a couple of times. I went to a Lutheran summer camp one year, and apparently I found this out later in life, that the saw is a common instrument in the Lutheran church. It's a holy instrument in the Lutheran
what?
Church.
What? It is not.
It is
not.
Sacred saw. I'm not even
You're
kidding.
Lying.
I'm kidding. No, you gotta look it up.
You're lying, right? Come on.
I'm not, actually. And I come from a town of Icelanders who, of course, like Norse people are, you know, tend to be Lutherans. And so the Icelandic Lutheran community had some saw players, and I saw them play, but they were all, you know, 60, 70, 80 years old. I figured it took a lifetime to learn how to play the saw. And it turns out there's a few little mechanical tricks. I was once at a party in a backyard in Toronto, Ontario, and a friend of ours came over with the saw, and he played a song and he carried a tune, and I was like so impressed that I said, you have to teach me how to do that. I can't believe that it's that easy to unlock. And he sat me down and gave me the what I call the 5-minute saw lesson, and that's about as much of a saw lesson as anyone needs. The rest of the work is yours to do on your own. But I mean, it's a really simple thing. You put a double bend in the saw. And as long as you've got that S-curve and you know where to find the sweet spot to strike with the bow, you get that ghostly tone. And then as you bend, more tension on the saw creates a higher pitch and less tension on the saw, a lower pitch. And then from there, you just... And then that beautiful vibrato is just accomplished by shaking your leg fairly vigorously. I'm shaking.
Oh my.
Maybe you can't see it, but my right knee is shaking up and down pretty wildly to create that vibrato. And if you can pull together all those little, you know, mechanical tricks, you can learn to play the saw. You just have to put a few hours in to both build the muscles that you've never used in your hand, and also to just learn to sort of stick those pitches. But
so you have to have chops, you have to practice.
I think a good ear is a really incredible asset to trying to learn the saw. So if you've got a good ear already and you're pretty good at latching onto a melody, and if you think linearly musically, you know, depending on which instrument you come from, there's a really linear aspect to the saw, just being more tension, less tension. And if you're a string player who tends to really favor a single string melody lines, there's some little crossover chops, I think, there. But yeah, you really, after a while, get a tactile sense of pitch. You can feel the pitch in the tension that you're creating in the saw.
That is amazing, and it is so. It's amazing to watch you do it and to see the leg moving and the whole, all of it. It's a lot. It's a little like violin. It's like Suzuki for lumberjacks, Suzuki method. Somebody
exactly.
said our friend Amy Putman. She just said that it's a working man's theremin.
Yes, absolutely.
Right?
Yes.
Yeah,
it's
and you
exactly
weren't you
that.
Weren't kidding
the
about the Lutheran
theremin.
Thing. I looked up the Lutheran thing. You weren't kidding.
Right? No, I know.
Wow.
I credit that bit of information to Natalia Saw Lady Peruse, who's a New York resident, who I would say is probably the world's leading authority on the musical saw. Also one of the great virtuosos on the instrument. And yeah, she's an incredible talent.
Well, we don't care about her. We have you. We don't care about her.
Yes, I'm a reasonable facsimile at times. So you weren't going to get Natalia. No, actually, you might have. But it's someone to look up if you're interested. If this piques anyone's interest, she's really a great authority, and you can watch a lot of her own. You listen to a lot of her own compositions. Watch her perform in the subways in New York. Yeah, pretty incredible talent. But that I attribute a lot of my saw background knowledge to Natalia. She's been a bit of a scholar in that department. So,
One question before we have you play your final number, Jackson Haldane. You also write songs and play guitar, I saw online.
Yes.
Yeah. And is that kind of your primary gig? Is your singer-songwriter?
Yeah, this kind of came to me as a bit of a lark. It ended up being quite a strong aspect of a live performance because it does make quite an impact. But
yeah, I'd say.
it's become a gimmick to lean on for sure. But I've been playing sort of bluegrass, roots, folk, blues kind of stuff most of my adult life. And yeah, I love to write songs and have been, you know, over the years, seen a bunch of the world and pretty much every square inch of my country. So yeah, it's been a good run, but I do like to write a song now and then and play a few different stringed instruments for sure.
Well, we'll look forward to seeing you south of the border once, you know, on the other side of this pandemic. And maybe I'll see you at a Canadian festival up there at some point. But I look forward to meeting you in person, and I'm happy we got to meet today this way.
Likewise.
And Jackson, you're going to play us out is it another waltz?
It's another waltz, yes. It's another waltz just a little further south, or a little further north from the last waltz. So the last waltz was the Tennessee waltz. We'll play the Kentucky waltz now. This is a great old Bill Monroe song. Maybe not as much in the popular canon as that last one, but I love the melody on this one. So see if I can knock some more rust off here and forgive my backing tracks. Kentucky, beneath the beautiful harvest moon, and I was the boy that was lucky, but it all ended too soon. As I sat here alone in the moonlight, I see your smiling face, and I long much more for your embrace in that beautiful Kentucky waltz. Thanks, everybody. Happy Sunday.
Jackson Holliday, and thank you so much.
Thank you, Susan. Have a great night.
You have a great night, too. Jackson Holliday and everybody. There it was, the Lutheran sacred instrument. The musical saw. Jackson Haldane joining us from Winnipeg, Manitoba. And we had an international guest. That's exciting. That's a first for me. Okay, before we welcome our second guest, tonight's second name will be your microbrew name. Your microbrew name. So the name of your beer, if you started your own microbrew, this is how you would name your craft beer. It's your grandfather's job, what your grandfather did for a living, plus a word you don't fully understand. Okay? It's a job your grandfather did and a word you don't fully understand. So mine, my craft brew would be called Farmer's Prerogative. Farmer's Prerogative. Okay, so I look forward to reading your craft beer names here in the comments. Again, a job your grandfather did, plus a word you don't fully understand. That's your micro brew name. Our next guest, I am so excited to welcome from her home in New York, New York, the one, the only, the godmother of folk music, indeed. Please welcome to the program, Christine Lavin.
Yeah! Hi, Susan. Susan, guess what? I saw Natalia.
You saw Natalia, that saw player?
Yes, in the subway. And I gave her a dollar. I thought, oh, this poor woman. She's playing in the subway, but she's smart. She's got a weapon.
It's true. She's got her own self-defense built right in there.
Yeah. I had no idea she was world famous. I just thought she was very good.
Isn't that wild, though? She's like, you know, world famous.
Yeah.
As are you. I'm thrilled to have you tonight. I'm so happy you could join us. This is so fun.
Oh, thank you.
I asked you if you would to play a song, and this is a song I really like. So thank you for indulging me.
Well, this is a song I wrote when I was on my way to the Kerrville Folk Festival. I flew from New York to Houston, Houston on to San Antonio, and in the Houston airport, I noticed a fly got on the plane. And then the doors closed, and we took off, and the plane was struck by lightning, and at that very moment, the fly and I switched bodies, and I wrote the song, and I was trapped inside the body of the fly. I'm a fly on a plane. I am buzzing all around. I got on in Houston. Uh-oh, I'm San Antonio bound. I'm not riding in coach. I think I'll fly first class. I'm on the head of a banker, zip, zip, I'm on the rim of her glass. My, oh, my, I'm a fly, taking a free ride on a plane. I'm a fly on a plane. My flight's a little erratic. The highest I've ever been was in a swing time cowgirl's attic. I didn't need to leave home, but now the die is cast. I guess my destiny is to roam and to fly really fast, very fast, mighty fast. My, oh my, I'm a fly, taking a free ride on a plane. When I get to San Antonio, I'm gonna make a lot of new fly friends. When I tell them that I'm from Houston, the eyes will bug out and they'll say, come again. Don't tell us no Texas tall tales. How did you get here? I'll say, I flew. All those San Antonio flies will say, man alive, we've got immense respect for you. Woo, woo, woo. Zip, zippity, doo-dah. Zip, zippity, yeah. Zip, zippity, doo-dah. Say, hey, Willie May, say, hey. I'm a fly on a plane. I got a lot of dreams. I never counted on a rolled up in flight magazine.
Fly on a plane from our friend Christine Lavin. You're the best. I love that song so much. Of course, you're on your way to Kerrville when you write a song like that.
Yeah. But you know, you're not a very sensitive person that you like that song. Because most, I'm telling you, some folk audiences, they are so traumatized by the end of the song, they don't even clap. They're like, what? He did? And I want to say, he's a fly.
fly. It's not like it's a puppy. It's a fly. It doesn't even have a name. You goddamn sensitive people.
You know, I grew up on a farm, so, you know, fly meeting its end is no big surprise at all. Christine, I'm so happy. I'm so happy that you're here, and it's so great to see you. I miss seeing you in person.
Well, likewise, Susan. It's great to see you on screen. You look wonderful.
Oh, thanks. You know, it's just been kind of an interesting endeavor, all this, you know, the live stream thing. And it's been, but the biggest fun has been reconnecting with, you know, favorite wonderful people. I wanted to ask you about what you're going to read for us, because I love that you're going to do this, and I didn't know. Yeah, tell us about this.
Well, I wrote this book, and it was published 10 years ago. So I'm working on a second volume, but I thought I would read a little chapter from this book, and this is an honest-to-God true story. It has to do with Robin Bateau. So this really, really happened. But I can't tell you the name of the chapter because it'll give it away. Although I have made my living all these years on stage, you know that I've never had any formal training. So when I got a phone call in the summer of 1998 asking me to play the part of evil stepsister Minerva in a one-time only benefit performance of Cinderella, I quickly said no. It was my friend violinist Robin Bateau on the other end of the line, and he was calling from a small theater in Connecticut where his neighbor Paul was putting on a night of entertainment to raise money for charity. The entertainment was a spoof of Cinderella, and Robin was the musical director. He told me he had just got word that the actress who was cast to play Minerva, the evil stepsister, had to drop out. He needed me in Connecticut in 2 days. I interrupted him, telling him, I have zero theater experience. I'm not the girl for the job. But Chris, he said, it's a benefit for Paul Newman's Hole in the Wall Gang Camp for Kids with Cancer. Oh, how could I say no to that? Robin left out a few details. The script was co-written by Paul Newman, that's his neighbor Paul, and A.E. Hotchner. And the evil stepmother was being played by Carol King. One of the evil stepsisters was Carol's daughter, Louise Goffin. The narrator was Joanne Woodward. The fairy godmother was Nathan Lane, and the fairy godfather was Paul Newman. There were two princes fighting over Cinderella, Broadway star James Naughton, and beloved actor Tony Randall. Cinderella was played by Julia Roberts. Tickets cost $1,000, and it was sold out. We arrived 5 minutes before the one and only rehearsal. Joanne Woodward stood at a podium, and this is what she explained to the audience they were about to see, the spoof of Cinderella. And she ended it with, and here comes poor Cinderella. Her stepmother and stepsisters are so mean to her. Julia Roberts crawled across the stage. First, she polished Louisa's shoes, then mine, and then she moved on to Carol. Even though I had no lines in this scene, I leaned down, I pointed at my right shoe, and I said, you missed a spot. Without a word, Julia Roberts repolished my right shoe and then went on with the scene. I was so proud. I had ad-libbed a line to Julia Roberts, and she ad-libbed a response. I'm an actress. Huh. Later on came my big moment. Joanne read, Minerva is a singer and has dreams of going to Hollywood to become a big star. I stepped up and with my guitar and sang the first verse of my song, What Was I Thinking? Then I sat down again. In this version of Cinderella, everything works out well for everyone in the end. And Joanne read, and the fairy godmother takes Minerva to Hollywood, where she becomes a big singing sensation. At that, Nathan Lane took me by the arm and swept me off stage. There were a few more loose ends to tie up, Cinderella and the cute prince, Jim Naughton, lived happily ever after, and then we all sang a song, an old-fashioned standard to which A.E. Hotchner had written new lyrics to reflect this particular Cinderella story. We gathered around the piano and were handed lyric sheets. I stood next to Nathan Lane. We sang through the song a couple of times. Walking off stage, I said to him how nervous I was, how I've never been in a play before. He rolled his eyes and walked away. In the dressing room, there was the guy's one and there was a girl's one. It was me with Carol King, Louise Goffin, Joanne Woodward, and Julia Roberts. Can you imagine? This is my first play. Julia wanted to put her hair up in pigtails as Cinderella, then shake the pigtails out as she transformed for the ball. But she couldn't find any elastics. There were rubber bands, but she wanted two of those smooth elastics so that her hair could shake out so naturally. So anyway, I told her, I said, I will find you some. I was on a mission for Julia Roberts. A woman in the box office found an elastic. I ran it back to the dressing room where Julia was in her underwear, thong underwear. Why does Julia Roberts wear thong underwear? Because she can, and she looks great. Julia found another elastic. She was ready to go. The theater opened, and the seats quickly filled. For the opening scene, I took my place on the bench next to Louise Goffin and Carol King. Joanne Woodward made her speech, and Julia Roberts crawled across the floor and polished our shoes. I did not ad-lib any lines this time. I was trying to be a professional. I admired Julia's hair up in those pigtails. Later on, I got up and sang a verse of What Was I Thinking? It got very little response from the crowd, but that was okay. They had no idea who I was. Then came Julia's scene where she slid the elastics out of her hair, took off her house coat to reveal a slinky gown, plus she was wearing Manola Blahnik shoes. She was so right to insist on elastic instead of rubber bands. I felt so proud of myself. I started to breathe easier. I only had one more thing to do. It was almost over. This wasn't so bad after all. I'm an actress. In the last scene, when everything works out, Joanne Woodward read, "And the fairy godmother brings Minerva to Hollywood, where she becomes a big singing sensation." With that, I stood up smiling, waiting for Nathan Lane to come sweep me off stage. I waited and I waited. No Nathan. Joanne Woodward fumbled with her script and looked around. I looked around. Where was Nathan? What was I supposed to do? Dead silence. Joanne repeated the line a little slower and a little louder. "And the fairy godmother brings Minerva to Hollywood, where she becomes a big singing sensation." I have no idea how much time ticked by. Maybe 10 seconds, but it felt like an eternity. Since I was supposed to go off into the wings, spirited away by my fairy godmother, I just went to plan B and I started to spin myself there. I stuck my arms out and started to madly spin, aiming for the opening near the back of the stage. I got closer and closer, and I got dizzier and dizzier. Soon I was close enough to throw myself into the darkness, so that's what I did. I banged into a piece of furniture in the wings, and it fell with a huge crash, and I heard the audience laughing. When I righted myself, who was standing over me, holding a script and frowning? Paul Newman. "What are you doing?" he whispered. "Making up your own lines and... who the hell are you?"
Nathan was supposed to get me," I whispered back. "But he didn't come get me. I didn't know what to do. I've never been in a play before. I'm a folk singer. Robin asked me to be in it. I've never been in a play before. I'm a folk singer."
I stopped jabbering because the lights came up and we all had to go on stage to sing the final song. I was so traumatized that I just moved my lips, closed my eyes, and pretended I was invisible. Nathan Lane was there for the finale, but why had he left me hanging? I wanted to ask him what happened. There was a party following the play where audience and actors mingled. I saw Nathan Lane all dressed in black, smiling and chatting with people. He looked happy and in a good mood, but I was too scared to talk to him. Maybe I shouldn't have told him I'd never been in a play. Maybe he didn't want to share a scene with a rookie. Maybe he was teaching me a lesson. Maybe that part was changed and nobody told me. I will never know, but I do know that if your first play, you share a dressing room and a stage with Julia Roberts, there is only one direction you can go from there. My theatrical career began, peaked, and crashed and burned all on the same night. The night I got yelled at by Paul Newman. By the way, the actress I was filling in for that night? Sarah Jessica Parker. Yeah, I'm always the first one you think of if she's busy.
Christine Lavin, the David Sedaris of acoustic music. Don't you think? You're kind of like, hey, it'd be fun to see you and David Sedaris. Like,
Oh, I love him, and I love his sister, too.
Oh, yeah, she's hilarious.
Yeah, she's a fun gal. But can you believe that? That was my one and only theatrical experience, sharing a dressing room with Julia Roberts and thong underwear.
And thong underwear, that's not something you forget. And then Paul Newman yelling at you. Lord.
Who the hell are you? Robin Bateau, how many people did he call before he called me? And I foolishly, did he call you, Susan?
He didn't call me, but I love him.
Yeah.
Christine, there's only one of you. You're irreplaceable.
Well, and thank you, Susan.
And these things happen to you. Like somehow you know, it makes sense that somehow this happened to you.
Yeah, and you know, people have told me, never tell anyone that happened to you. Are you kidding me? I have to tell people that happened to me. But now I live in fear of the wrath of Nathan Lane, because I know he has quite a temper. And if he knows I've blabbed that he missed a cue.
Yeah, you're hurt his career, because his career obviously is suffering. So Christine is going to leave us with a special treat.
I'm going to take my headphones off for this.
Okay.
Okay.
All right.
Okay.
Thank you very much. You know, one of the great things about coming to festivals is seeing so many terrific performers. And one of my favorites is going to be here tomorrow night. I just wanted to tell you so you know ahead of time. Susan Werner has a brand new record coming out on September 15th. It's called Time Between Trains. And it is the record that Susan Werner fans have been hoping that she would make. It's so beautiful. The first thing I thought of was Dar Williams, and then I thought of Joni Mitchell's Blue album. That's how good this record is. So since Susan is from Philadelphia, this is how we start a buzz. I am telling you, this is the best record that I've heard in years. So you get it. If you can only buy one record the month of September, you buy mine. But if you can buy two, you buy Susan Werner's. I tell you, it's a great, great record. All right.
What the hell was that?
That was a little surprise for you, Susan. That was 23 years ago. I was bragging about your record coming out.
Tonight, a treat, and it is something like this. Here we go. The godmother of folk music. It's Christine. Awesome. Love you.
Come on.
Christine Lavin if she's new to you. She's one of the funniest people ever to write songs in the United States of America. She's the best-est, Christine Lavin. Before we do our final act this evening, we have a few of your names from your microbrew craft beer names. Robin Siegel's craft beer name, Dressmaker's Miracle. I would buy that, right? That's a great name for a beer. Dressmaker's Miracle. Mary Wallace Weber, Construction Blessed. That sounds good. It sounds light, right? Construction Blessed. Sounds light. And then Bill Jordan, his beer is Carpenter's Syncretism. That's a good one because I have no idea what syncretism at all means. At all. No, at all. So thank you, everybody, for tuning in tonight to Susie on Sundays. Tonight is the variety show, the first. Have you had some variety? You have had some variety tonight. And we do have one more final performer for you tonight. Again, next weekend, next Sunday, Kathy Mattea, and on Sunday, May 9th, Piano Bar. I'll take your songs, your song requests in real time during that show. And I'm Sumsan Los Lopez for National Public Radio. Okay, so this name, the last name you might work on tonight, if you'd like a formula for your name, your rock star name, your rock star name. If you've never had a rock star name, the formula for creating your rock star name is to take a current pet's name and a current street name. Current pet's name, current street name. That will produce your rock star name. My rock star name is Adrian Midnight Cove. Right? Doesn't she sound interesting? Adrian Midnight Cove. So our final performers this evening, join us from Sacramento, California. Please welcome Marina Savitska. Hi, Marina.
Hey.
How are you?
How are you?
I'm doing great. And you've seen our variety show this evening. You've seen some unusual things that maybe you haven't seen before or haven't seen back-to-back, baton twirling and a musical saw.
That was great.
It was something. Yes, it was something. So you're joining us tonight with your performers. And maybe before I reveal what your performers do, maybe we should just go for it. You think we should just go for it?
It will.
Yes. Okay. You're cutting in and out just a little bit, which I'm not terribly concerned about, because mostly you have to hear me, right? Because I'm going to be playing the musical accompaniment for this performance. Okay, from Sacramento, Marina Savitska.
Thank you.
The Savitsky Cats, Marina Savitska. Wow! That was amazing.
Thank you.
How fantastic. That was just spectacular. I even ran out of cat songs to play because you had so many tricks. So I had to bring some songs back, and then there were like three Cat Stevens songs thrown in there. And just, it was just fantastic. How, first of all, who was your co-worker, your co-presenter, your co-artist there with you?
Mom, she's more than 20. So she, so have like each kind of like I'm with the cats.
You know, I heard every other word of that, and that doesn't matter because it's just all fabulous. And there's nothing, I mean, it was the best contribution to the entire Susie on Sundays series. Marina, I've done, I think, about 60 shows now, and that was by far the most unexpected and fabulous performance of the entire series. I am honored to have you. Can you hear me now?
Hear you?
Yeah, you can hear me. Yeah, you're cutting in and out a little bit. You know what we'll do? Let me wrap it up this way and say these are the Savitsky Cats, and you can book them for your own events and for all around the country. They perform. They've performed coast to coast. I read about them. They're fantastic. So look for the Savitsky Cats when they come to a theater or a performance near you. Marina Savitska and the Savitsky Cats. Thank you, Marina.
Thank you for us to.
Yes, thank you. Thank you. Well, when I said a variety show, did you get a variety? Yep. Thank you for tuning in. Thanks again to the Savitsky Cats, the one and only Christine Lavin, and Jackson Haldane joining us from Winnipeg. What's new, pussycat? Whoa, whoa, whoa. What's new, pussycat? Whoa, whoa, whoa. See you next week for Kathy Mateo.